I'm very happy to be back at our St. Herman's Conference. It is for me every year one of the real highlights of the year. There's so much joy and happiness, and because we move around, I get to learn new things about our diocese and about living in the West every year. Last year, we had it in Seattle, where I learned that I need to bring several pairs of shoes, because I brought two pairs, which were both dissolved by the rain. And some of you remember walking downtown with me with shoes with no bottoms on them, because the bottoms fell off in the rain. And I'm learning this year things about Oregon, which is a very interesting state. I didn't know that the Oregon Trail ended just down the road from here. That's very interesting. But I'm also learning more peculiar things about this state, like the propensity for Oregon to name all of its coffee shops coffee cafes, which I find redundant. But there are some original names, too, like the very creatively named Rimsky-Korsakoffy, which is actually a real thing. Though, ironically, I'm told they only serve tea. So, it's also very interesting to be in a state where you wake up completely surrounded by fog, so thick that you can't see through it, and the local priest says, "Look, it's a sunny day." I'm very sorry, I don't know if he's here, but I'm very sorry that I missed Father Serge's talk. Obviously, the topic of fasting scared me too much, and I stayed away. So I'm going to talk today about something different. I want to talk about prayer in our daily life as Orthodox Christians. And I want to start like I always start, with a single phrase. The life in Christ is a mystery. I always, not always, but most of the time start with that line just to remind us, whatever we're talking about, whether it's something very lofty and interesting or very simple and practical, that everything about our life as Orthodox Christians is a mystery. It goes beyond ordinary everyday life and draws us into something much greater than what we normally see and experience around us. We're so used to seeing life in ordinary terms, everything about life, even other people. When we see them in ordinary terms. They're objects, they're usual, they're customary. But our life as Orthodox Christians is far deeper than this. We are drawn into a mystery, something that is deeper, more wonderful than we normally understand and see. And at the heart of this mystery for each of us as Christian people is prayer. And I want to talk about prayer today because I think it's one of these topics that is so much at the center of our life as Christians that we sometimes don't think about it. Or when we do think about it, we think about it in strange terms. You know, the church teaches us that prayer is what we're created for, that it's at the very center of our being as human people fashioned by God. It's not just something that we do, it's who we are. We are creatures that pray, right? So much of our life as human beings is common with other creatures. We know that we're very similar to certain other animals. We know that we're very similar to a lot of creation. And yet we are the only creatures who, with a full rational mind and freedom, give glory to God through a life of prayer. It makes us completely unique in all of the created world. We're the only creatures who love God. Even the whole of creation sings praise to God. And all of creation prays in a kind of broad sense. We're the only people, we're the only creatures whom God has fashioned to have prayer alive in our hearts as a thing that we freely do. And yet it's so disheartening to me to see how often prayer is misunderstood by people in the church. Rather than being a source of joy and something profoundly precious and beautiful and special, it becomes a source for very many people. And don't worry, I'm not going to call and ask you to self-identify yourselves, but for many people, and I'm sure many here in this room, it becomes a source of frustration and of stress. There's a kind of spirit of obligation that sneaks up and creaks its way into our life of prayer. And so prayer starts to remind us of something burdensome. When we think of prayer, we start to think of chores. We start to think of our failures to do it rightly. I'll give an example. One of the most common confessions that I hear, or statements in confession, is people who come to confess, "Father, I haven't said my prayers." And let's be clear, it's good to confess this. When we don't do what we ought to do, what we want to do, we should come before God to confess it. So it's not the fact that this is confessed that I find sorrowful. What I find sorrowful is that very often it's confessed as if admitting that you had failed to file your taxes. Right? I haven't said my prayers, and now God's going to punish me. Right? It's admitted almost kind of a legal obligation that we have failed in. Penalties will come next. But what sort of spirit does this attitude towards prayer create in us? If this is how we think of prayer, it's a legal obligation that's put upon us, and if we fail in that obligation, someone's going to come after us. What spirit does that create when we start to pray, when we try to pray? First and foremost, it creates a spirit of obligation. Right? We understand this term, of having to do something. It's a requirement. It can create feelings of constraint. I'm sort of trapped by all of these prayers that I'm supposed to do that I can't do. A spirit of necessity. If I don't get this done, something's going to go terribly wrong. Almost a feeling in some people's minds, I encounter this very often, of danger, as if God is so upset that we haven't fulfilled our set prayers, that he is going to unleash some wrath against us and that our life is in peril. So it creates a spirit of necessity, danger, and constraint. Which, interestingly, we have a petition in the Divine Liturgy that we repeat four times in every Divine Liturgy, where we ask God to deliver us from precisely those things: necessity, danger, and constraint. It's sorrowful, then, that our attitude towards prayer, our misunderstandings of prayer, often create in our hearts the very same sentiments from which we ask God to deliver us when we come together in the church. But how far are these sorts of sentiments from the images of prayer that we receive in the fathers of the church? I love to quote the fathers. And there are just passage after passage in the fathers that are beautiful about prayer. But when we hear their words, they sometimes shock us because they sound so different from what is often felt in the heart. St. Tikhon of Zadonsk, for whom my little parish is named, says this: "As a bird without wings, as a soldier without arms, so is a Christian without prayer." Right? It's so central to his life that to think of life without prayer, you might as well think of a bird that has no wings. St. Gregory of Nyssa, who wrote many, many centuries before St. Tikhon, said, "Prayer is the delight of the joyful and the comfort of those who are afflicted. It is the intimacy with God and contemplation of things we cannot see." These are the words that the fathers use when they talk about prayer. Not obligation and necessity and constraint or fear, but intimacy, love, joyfulness, comfort. And I'm sure that everyone in this room knows examples of this kind of prayer that we have seen in other people. We've all seen people who pray, and it creates in them radiant, joyful hearts. I remember as a young boy going for the first time to a monastery and being quite afraid, because I was afraid all these men with long beards in black robes, who all they did every day was pray and were very serious and frightening. And I was really nervous. And then I went to the monastery, and after about 10 minutes, I said to myself, "They're all like little kids. They're all so happy. They're joyful." And I'm sure you've met people like that, people who pray, really pray in the depths of their heart. And what does it make them? Not sorrow, somberful, people, but people with a kind of joy that's a mystery, that goes beyond the world. They find joy even when everything is painful and sorrowful around. So I want to say three things about prayer that I hope will be useful. And the first is this: God doesn't need it. God has no need of my prayer or yours. It is not an obligation that God requires of you as Orthodox Christians. This, I think, is the greatest misunderstanding that people have about prayer, that somehow God needs us to pray in order to, whatever, to love us, to save us, to care for us. That he puts this requirement on our shoulders, and if we fail in it, somehow our relationship with God is going to be destroyed. So let me say very, very clearly, a second time, God does not need your prayers. We are taught by the church, God has no needs. God, we say, is all-powerful. We have lots of theological terms that are unimportant for us today. Omnipotent, self-sustaining, all of this. But they all amount to the same thing. God doesn't need anything from anybody. God, in his infinite power, knows everything there is to know without you and me telling him. Right? God knows that there are floods in Russia even before we say, God, there are floods in Russia. Right? That doesn't mean we shouldn't pray this. I'll come to that. But it's important that we understand the basic idea. God knows all. God knows what you need and what I need, even before we ask him. God knows I'm a sinner, even before I confess to him my sins. God knows what's good for me, even before I tell him. We often try to tell God, you know, God, I'm really suffering, and here's what would make it better. But God knows that we're suffering. And God knows generally far better than we do what we actually need to heal our suffering. But similarly, God does not impose prayer upon you, upon any person, upon Christian people, as a requirement for salvation. God does not say to us, I am going to save you, but only with the following conditions. And the following conditions are you must say the following prayers at the certain times. God the Father saves us through his love, which is unconditional. There are no strings attached to it. The Fathers are very clear that even if God made the tiniest requirement of us, that would mean heaven was an empty place. Because we are so accustomed to sinning that even if it were the tiniest burden placed upon us and that were a requirement for salvation, that we simply could not obtain it. God gives us salvation. He gives us his love freely and unequivocally. Praying to God does not make us love him more. This is another common misconception. We find in the Fathers very often, we find in the lives of the saints, that saint so-and-so prayed to God and God loved him for his prayer, or for her prayer. We've had a whole string of wonderful women saints this week, Saint Anna, Saint Hannah the prophetess. We had the week before a string of others, young and old. And it says in the lives of the saints over and over again, God loved them because of their prayer. But we never hear the phrase, God did not love so-and-so because they did not pray. We never hear that. Prayer is not something that makes God change his attitude towards us. God has loved each of you from the moment he fashioned you with a love that cannot change because it simply could not be any greater than it has always been. The prayer that we sometimes offer, God, please love me more, is a prayer that really has no meaning. We were discussing in the van on the way over here my dislike of silly English phrases that make no sense, like very most reverend. Right, in English, once you say most, you can't say any more. And I often think we ought to say, you know, really specially very, gosh darndest most reverend. I mean, it's silly in English to say this. Once something is most, you can't get any more mostest. Right? And God loves us from the moment he fashions us, from the moment you're in your mother's womb, with a love that is superlative, that cannot get any more, nor can it ever get any less. Prayer is not about changing God's love for us. Prayer, in fact, is not about God. Prayer is something done for us. So if the misconception is that God needs prayer, here's the real truth. Prayer, the church teaches us, is a gift that God gives to us, for us. It is a gift to the human person. It is a gift, God says, that allows us to use simple things, words, tunes, hymns, songs, poetry, which is what a lot of the prayers are or were in their original forms. Even physical things like bows or a prayer rope. Simple things to draw us into communion with himself. To draw us into those things the fathers talk about. Intimacy with himself. Tenderness. Closeness to himself. God gives us prayer as a gift that we can have access to all of that, not through some elaborate ritualistic code of entry, but through the very simple realities of words and thoughts, tunes in our heart. Where we are so accustomed to seeing prayer as a chore and an obligation, God always sees it as a gift of his love. It is as if God says to us in giving us prayer, take this, take prayer, and your heart can become my heart. Imagine what it is for God to say such a thing. All you have to do is this little thing, and your words can be my words. Your life can be my life. Do this little thing, and your heart can be joined to mine. The creator of the universe says this to us, to each of us. Prayer is something given for our sakes. And if we can start to understand that one thing and nothing else, I never like to say this, but maybe I will. Now that I've made my main point, you can all nap for the rest of the talk. Because if, yes, he says in the back. If you only remember one thing, that's what I want you to remember. That prayer is something God gives you to change your life. Not as an obligation to put on your shoulders. And if we receive it like that, how do we receive other gifts? We're coming into the gift-giving and gift-receiving time of year. When someone gives us a gift, we rejoice. Because they have chosen to give us something, a freely given offering. Because it enhances, it blesses our life, whether in some deep, meaningful way or in some very trivial little way. It's something given. We rejoice in it. And that should be our response to prayer. To be happy. To be filled with anticipation that God is giving us something that can change our lives. So that's the first point about prayer. The second point about prayer, a misconception that I want to correct, is that prayer, true prayer, is not an action. It's a condition of the heart. It's not something that we do. It's an aspect of who we are. If prayer is a gift of intimacy from God, then it can't just be a collection of things that we do. What sort of relationship is just made up of going through the motions? Right? Maybe you've experienced some relationships like that where you go and you say, hello, hi. I always am amazed. Every culture has its own useless conversation patterns, right? In England, when you see someone, you invariably say, are you all right? Which always causes American tourists to feel, do I look sick? What's wrong? But in England, the phrase, are you all right, is just sort of, how are you doing? And nobody expects you to actually answer this question, right? You're supposed to say, oh, I'm fine, thanks. And you? Right? If you go up to someone and say, "Are you all right?" and they say, "Oh, but let me tell you, I had a horrible day this morning," and they're just like, "I didn't really care. I was just saying." And in this country, you go up and say, "How are you today?" And we don't really care. No one really expects you to say anything other than, "Oh, I'm fine, a little tired, a little busy, but Right? And we have this conversation 1,000 times with the same person. And we're no closer to them than we are to a stranger. Simply going through the motions of a relationship is not the same thing as having a relationship. Going through the motions of prayer is not the same thing as praying. Because prayer isn't just a collection of motions, of actions, of words. It's something in us. It's how we exist. But we often equate it to the actions. We're Orthodox people. We are lovers of formulae and rituals, and these are holy things. But we have a tendency to make idols out of our rituals. And so we have a ritual of saying, "I will do my prayers, and my prayers will look like this," which is a very good thing. But soon the form becomes all we pay attention to. And it's the same thing, I'm afraid, as going to God and saying, "How are you doing?" "Fine, good, me too, a little busy." And it becomes just as empty as the conversations that we don't really have with other people. When our prayer simply equals the words that we say and nothing more, the actions that we undertake, something is not right. The fathers teach us that the purpose of the actions, of our words in prayer, of the things we do, is to condition the heart, to change it, to mold it into something different. This is why the fathers call, and here I'm going to use a big theological term, they all call prayer ascetical. Do you know this word, ascetical? Does anyone not? You can admit that you don't know it if you don't. Does anyone not know what ascetical means? Good, thank you, someone admitted it. Ascetical is a sports term. How many of you knew that? Very good. Ascetical is an old Greek sporting term. It related to the exercises that men would do before performing in the arena, before wrestling, before running, before performing in the games. And all of the preparation, what we would think of today as working out, right? Going to the gym and working out, whatever that is, that would be called askesis in Greek. It's conditioning yourself so that you are equipped and able to do something. But the whole idea of askesis, of working out, is to make you ready for something else. In and of itself, it's just a preparation, right? The athletes would go, and I suppose they didn't really have free weights back in the Greek times, but they would do the equivalent of going to the gym and lifting weights and running on the treadmill, not because they really loved running on the treadmill. I had to do that after an operation, and there's nothing quite so boring in all of creation as running on a treadmill, right? But one runs on a treadmill, if it's an athlete, because you want to be able to run a marathon and not die halfway through it. Or if you're recovering from an illness, you go onto the treadmill, not because you love the treadmill, but because you want to be healed so that you can walk down the street again. Prayer, the fathers say, is ascetical. It is something which does something else. The words of our prayer are like, sorry, this analogy seems almost too ridiculous, but I'm going to run with it. It's like the free weights of our spiritual life, right? The words of our prayer are there to condition the heart, to make it receptive to the love of God, to show it what intimacy with God looks like, what it feels like. All of the prayers that we do, all of the ascetical things that we do, equip us for a new spiritual life. And by the way, fasting is also an ascetical exercise. We don't fast just because we really, really like soybeans, right? We fast because we want to grow closer to Christ. And this is often misunderstood within our own church. Some of you know, because I like to tease people about this, that I am not very keen on the tradition of so-called fasting with these replacements of everything that you've given up. I've given up meat, but I have these 12 exact meat substitutes. And I've given up cheese, but I have 34 flavors of fake cheese. Again, I have no problem if you need to get some protein and this is a way to do it. Father Serge probably talked about this. That's fine. I have no problem using a little, you know, replacement this and replacement that to help us along. Fasting is not supposed to be horrible. But at the same time, we soon cross a line where the, certainly in San Francisco, where we have access to all of the organic hippie food of the country, it all originates there. It's quite possible to have fasting food that tastes quite a lot better, actually, than the food that you have the rest of the year. And at some point you have to say, what on earth is the point of this? Fasting is supposed to change the way we think and live, not just to replace it with an exact likeness so that at the end of the day we can say, I didn't have any dairy products for 40 days, and now God likes me more. I mean, when you think of it in these terms, it's absurd. God doesn't need us to give up meat or dairy, but the church knows that if we do this in the right spirit, it softens our hearts. It makes us more receptive to the presence of God. Going without something is often a very powerful way of learning to appreciate the presence of other things. Sometimes in very lofty spiritual terms, sometimes in very practical terms. I remember as a college student, I still ate meat back then, and I quite liked a cheeseburger. And I remember Great Lent, and I would commute, and every time I would drive by a burger joint, I would struggle, right? And that very basic struggle, saying, gosh, I really want a cheeseburger, at least gave me pause to think, well, why am I not pulling into the drive-thru right now and getting one? So even just on a basic level, it makes you stop and think. But at a much deeper level, fasting makes us aware of the presence of so many things that we normally don't notice. It's ascetical, and so is our prayer. The words of our prayer are designed to make the heart sensitive to things it doesn't normally notice, it normally doesn't see. I remember the Akafist prayer, which we say every Friday in my parish. We do the Akafist to the Mother of God every week. And sometimes I'm awestruck by that prayer. Sometimes I have to say, I'll admit to you, I hear the prayer from beginning to end, and my heart isn't focused, and I don't really notice. I'm a weak person just like everybody else, and there are times when I'm not very sensitive. But then there are other times when I hear that prayer, and one line will just pierce through your soul, and you'll see something about the Mother of God, about Christ, about yourself, that you never saw before in your whole life. And at that moment, these words, which are hundreds of years old, at that moment they change you. And you're changed forever after that moment. This is what prayer is supposed to do, to change your heart. Because that's what real prayer is. It's a heart that loves God. St. Paul very famously said, what's his most famous quotation on prayer? Does anyone know? It's one sentence long. And I know that you all have St. Paul memorized from beginning to end. So just go through and remember. Pray without ceasing. See, it's only three words. Pray without ceasing. And I can assure you that the one thing St. Paul certainly did not mean when he said that was always say prayers without ever stopping. Because that's not possible. At the very least, a human person sleeps. St. Paul himself worked. And you can't rationally, linguistically speak prayers all the time. That is not what that saying means. What St. Paul is saying is your heart should be transformed by prayer so that your life is an unending prayer, whether or not you happen to be speaking words to God, whether or not you happen to be awake. We have many examples of the lives of the saints who are deep in prayer even when they're asleep, because that's simply the state of their heart. The heart has a power to be in communion with God even when their mind is dozing off. The third point I want to make is that prayer is creative. That is, it has the power to create newness in our hearts. So many things in our life are stagnant and stultifying. We're stagnant within them. We start something, we stop it. We go into some action, we come out of some action, and we're exactly the same as we were before we began. And sometimes, sadly, we see prayer in exactly this way. We start to pray, we finish our prayers, and we leave exactly like we were before, the same. But true prayer is not stagnant, it is creative. It changes the person who engages in it. True prayer never leaves you the same at the end as when you began. True prayer fulfills what we ask God in the 50th Psalm when we say to him, "Create in me clean heart, O God, and renew a new and right spirit within me." Prayer creates something different in us. And we should always have that in mind when we start to pray. That this isn't just something I'm going to do and then I'm going to go have lunch, or I'm going to say my prayers and then go do my chores. We should always approach prayer with the firm expectation that I'm going to say my prayers for the next 10 minutes and then I'm going to leave a different person. And I'll go do my chores. But as a different person, something will be different about me. Do I have enough time, Father, to say a few practical points? Okay. Forgive me, I shouldn't have told my very long story. Let me make 4 points on practical guidance for praying. And I'm talking about praying that you do at home or at school or college. I'm not talking at this moment about prayer in the church. I want to give a few bits of concrete advice on how you can pray better in the lives that you live. And I like to root this primarily in my experience of talking for a long time, 15 years or so, with college students trying to pray and facing the struggles of prayer, coming more recently to confession with the difficulties of prayer. So a little counsel gleaned from the fathers. The first, frequency is more important than duration. Okay? The frequency of your prayer is far more significant to allowing prayer to really blossom in your heart than the length of your prayer. One of the greatest pitfalls to trying to pray, especially for zealous people, especially for people who are busy and have a lot going on, like most of you do in your life, is the perceived length of prayer, particularly for Orthodox people, because we like a lot of prayers. And the prayer book prayers are quite long. The prayers in the morning, there are a lot of them. The prayers before sleep, again, rather a lengthy service. And people look at it and they say, "I just can't do it. I can't do all of that. I don't have the time. I don't have the strength." Or we often see the pitfall of simply trying to take on more than you can actually manage, thinking you can do it all in great zeal. I'm going to go and I'm not going to skip a single prayer. I'm going to do them all. Or we come up with a rule. Sometimes I'm amazed by people who come up with rules that are actually quite a bit longer than the prescribed prayers. I'm going to do it all plus 5 akathists or whatever it is. And we manage to do it for a day or two, a week or two, maybe a month. And then we're trapped by it. We can't do it anymore. Life catches up, work catches up, and it crumbles and we fall. What's the inevitable result of these things? A flurry of activity at the beginning, and then it peters out, and then it dies. And I see over and over again people who have basically stopped praying altogether because they've gone through this experience a few times. Every time I try to pray, I hear this a lot. Every time I try to pray, I manage to do it for a week or two, but then I can't carry on, and then I just stop altogether. And that creates a feeling of defeat and abandonment in our heart. But this isn't how you train a heart, any more than it's how you train a physical body. Anyone here who exercises, I always feel a little duplicitous talking about all of these exercising analogies, since I quite clearly don't exercise very often. But exercise analogies are very good. And anyone who does exercise knows that if you're not physically fit, and the decision you take to repair that is to go to the gym and for 11 hours live the heaviest weights possible, that this actually does far less good for you than going to the gym every day for 15 minutes and doing a little work, doing a little strengthening. That if you do that pattern of regular, frequent exercise, much more physical benefit comes to you than sitting there and powerlifting until you can't move. Because, of course, what happens the next day? I do say this from personal experience. What happens the next day? You can't lift anything, including yourself, right? It's the very same thing with our spiritual life. If we go and we try to lift a mountain in prayer, it will crush us, it'll defeat us, because we're not strong enough. But frequency is the source of strength. Regular prayer, even if it be brief prayer, has the power to strengthen the heart much more powerfully than a very long prayer that we only manage to do once every 5 or 6 days. It's much better to have a short prayer rule that you're able to keep every day. And this is my guidance for people. With the blessing of your spiritual father, keep a rule that is short, but that you can keep. Don't create a rule that is long and which you know full well you're not going to keep. It's much more beneficial to you to have a short rule that you keep every day. And you have to be wise in this, particularly as students. My experience of students is that you tend to have, I know you don't like mornings very much, but you tend to have much more control as students over your morning than you do over your evening, right? In the evening, things crop up. Oh, I've got to cram for a test, or I've got to go to this meeting, or whatever. Things happen, and you lose control. And if the only time you set aside to pray is in the evening, very often prayer just becomes very irregular. You want to pray, but things happen. You have more control over your morning. You can set your alarm 5 minutes earlier, get up, and the chance of being distracted and having to do something else are much slighter in the morning. So be wise, not just with how long the prayers are, but with when you pray, so that you can find the opportunity to do that thing which is very important, which is to make your prayer regular, every day, like your breath, like getting up. I often advise people to attach your prayers in the morning to something physical. The advice that was given to me that I always still maintain, I can't get rid of it, is feet hitting the floor. I was given the guidance by my spiritual father. The moment your feet swing off the bed and hit the floor, start to pray. Not after I go have my coffee and brush my teeth and read the web or whatever. That very second. And soon it just becomes a habit. You get up, your feet hit the ground, and you start to pray. Rhythm, familiarity, stability, these are important. The second practical point, the first is that frequency is more important than length, more powerful than length. The second point I want to make is that the power of your prayer, the intensity of your prayer, is more important than a Pharisaical approach to the words of it. We always should remember as Orthodox Christians, because it's so important a prayer to us, the prayer of the repentant thief, who was granted paradise for a single sentence, "Lord, remember me in thy kingdom." God did not require him to recite a long, worked-out confession. His heart cried out to him with profound depth and repentance, and in that instant, the Lord saved him. But we often ourselves fall prey to a kind of Pharisaical mindset that unless things are done in just a certain way, with just a specific set of texts, that the whole package becomes somehow void. I've heard many, many times in confession, Father, I'm afraid that my prayers haven't been real prayers, my evening prayers. I said, well, what do you mean by that? Well, I tried to say the evening prayers, but my children were crying, so I had to leave out a couple of the prayers and only did, you know, four or five of them rather than all of them. As if taking out a few of them for this reason somehow invalidated the entire process. We should always remember that the Pharisees in the time of Christ knew all the prayers. They knew how to pray. They knew all of the texts. They knew all of the psalms. They knew all of the psalters. And yet Christ, time and again, calls their prayer empty. We need to seek out prayer that touches our hearts and invokes in us the zeal of the repentant thief. For some, the prayer that does that is going to be very lengthy and long. I know of someone, for example, who every day prays the Akafist to the Bogorodica, to the Mother of God, and the Akafist to St. Nicholas, and the Akafist to St. Seraphim as their morning rule. Three Akafists. And I'm quite confident that this person, at every second of those very long prayers, that his heart burns with the love of God. For him, those prayers ignite him to spiritual life. For other people, a very short prayer has that power, and the long prayer at the beginning of the day may actually distract them until they gain the strength to dwell for a longer period of time in these prayers. The gauge of its truth, of its power, is not its length, but what it does to the hearts. Better, it's sometimes said, particularly in the monastic fathers, better to say every day as you rise from sleep one prayer, one paragraph that causes your heart to love God than to start every day with 45 minutes of prayers that you simply read through and do not heed in any way, that you recite absently. But this leads me to my third practical point, which is to talk about the prayer book. I hope most of you know what this is, this one or the Slavonic version. I want to talk about how to approach the prayer book, and my practical point is that the prayer book should be considered like a helpful friend, not like a lord and master in and of itself. The prayer book is one of the most beautiful gifts that the church gives to us to teach us how to pray. But we misuse it so often, and that leads to our frustration and to our sorrow. We misread it by just opening up like an instruction manual, like how to put together a new refrigerator. Well, I just go through these steps and then it's done, then I have a refrigerator. And we sometimes approach prayer in the same way. Evening prayer. I will read all of these things through to here, and then I will have prayed. Right? As if just scanning through it was the equivalent of praying, that's what it means to have this book and to use this book. But I assure you with full confidence, it's possible to recite every word in this book and still not pray. The prayer book is not a dictate given to us, but it's a gift of guidance to be a teacher. The prayer book shows you and me the kind of words that real prayer has inspired in the heart of the saints. It gives us images, it bears witness to the fruits of real prayer in the lives of devout Orthodox Christians. It's as if to say, you want to know what the heart will sing out when it really loves God. Here it is. This will show you. If you want to know what the heart will sing when it feels real repentance, I will show you. If you want to know what a heart should, the spirit that should be in a heart when it's struggling to repent, when it doesn't quite know how to repent, I'll show you that spirit too. When you want to know what spirit should be in your heart at the end of the day, as you're preparing to sleep, I'll show you that. If you want to know what things should be in your heart and in your mind when you rise up into a new day, I'll show you that. The prayer book is a beautiful witness to how our heart can speak. It shows us the fruits of a heart that loves God. It shows us what prayer sounds like, what it feels like, what it looks like, because we don't know these things. St. Paul says very beautifully, we do not know how to pray as we ought. This is why in our church, we don't suggest to people in our tradition for prayers, just go pray whatever comes into your heart. In many Christian traditions today, in Christian groups, that's the form of prayer that's prescribed. Go home and just say to God, whatever's in your heart. Well, I will confess to you, I often don't know what's in my heart. I don't know what's there. I try to know. But my heart is very often a mystery to me. I hope you understand a little of that yourselves. Sometimes I want to tell God something in my heart, but I don't know what words to use. There are times when I feel I want to give glory to God, but I don't know how to do it. Sometimes there are just deep groanings in the depths of our soul. We know we want to pray, but we have no idea what to say. That's where the prayer book gives us guidance. If we just stand up and say to God, whatever's in our heart, forgive me for being frank, our prayers start to sound daft very quickly. Because we don't really understand. And we fall into the traps of just reciting to God things that he already knows. God, my car ran out of gas today. Oh, he knows this. Or we find ourselves being paltry and ineffective in the things we want to do. I want to say thanks to God because he's given me a great blessing. And I go to God and I say to him from the depth of my heart, gee, thanks. Right? Which is inept. I know my heart wants to say so much more than that, but I don't know how. And then we turn to the prayer book and it gives us an example. If you want to give thanks to God, here's what thankful hearts sound like. So let this book, rather than be something which weighs us down, like this great manual that's just sitting on our icon corner saying, unless you do everything in this book, you're going to have to repent. Let us look at it instead. It's a gem, it's a gift given to us by the saints of the church to help our heart learn the words to say, so that when I want to give thanks to God, I can say more than just, gee, thanks. And when I want to ask God to bless my day, I can say that with power, and my heart can learn what it means to say these things. Let me wrap up. I could go and I could make lots of more practical points, but I think maybe this gives us enough to start with. And with all of that being said, my hope is this, that the real reality of prayer becomes something that all of you cherish even more than you do, that's more loved by you, by all of us, every day of our life. We are Christians. By God's grace, we are alive within his church, and this means we have a love for prayer. I have to say, whenever I hear you all burst into song and pray together, I feel incredible joy. There is love for prayer that's just alive in us. Thanks be to God for the church that she's taught us that. But let us take that love that we feel when we're together and we sing our prayers aloud, when we're in the church. Let us go then back to school or to the office or to college or whatever it may be, and recognize that prayer is something that God will give us even there in the midst of our practical living out of life. That this gift of a changed heart is something that is practically attainable. Because even though prayer, like the whole of our life in Christ, is a mystery, something we'll never fully understand, never fully comprehend, nevertheless, Christ calls each of us, you, me, all of us, into the depths of this mystery. He says, I am here and I want you to be here with me. And I want to assure all of you that true prayer, deep prayer, is not something reserved just to a few great saints. It's not something reserved just for elders or to other people. God wishes to give it to each of us, to you and to me. And he will give it. May we each of us receive it, you and I together. And may we be changed by this gift that God gives us, by real prayer, into images of his glory and his love in the world. Amen. Thank you.